Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I think they can't respond, right? Everybody is on mute.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, good afternoon. So let me just take you through some of the reforms that has happened, because I'm sure many of you have attended the last first of the sessions, first of the series, Mr. W. R. Reddy Garu speaking about general agriculture. So this time I thought I will not spend too much time, but I'll be happy if you ask me questions on the practical issues of these kind of reforms and why these things have come into picture. I'll also try and give you as many examples from my own life, and then when I worked with ITC or when I worked with Basics, we had been doing this. And also, I've been one of the first trader for ITC. That's how these agricultural rules or regulations across central and state had played a very important role in how we developed the agribusiness systems over a period of time. And we did a lot of policy lobbying, etc. But to be precise, a trader has a lot of problem, because in India, agriculture, as you understand, that agriculture is a state subject. So center can do a lot of reforms, but it takes a lot of efforts from the state to either to align or sometimes to even change it to the requirement of the center. And many states may not even comply with. So, which you have been seeing now, some of the states have actually really progressive in their thinking. So they adopt only selectively what that needs to be done to the sector. So let's look at the context on which we are speaking. This is going to be, I'm speaking on a very smaller kind of a sense, in the sense that if you people have heard in general the agriculture, I'm not spending too much time. But in terms of the first point is a perspective, what we are looking at is in terms of 58% of primary source of living in India comes from the agriculture. Either it is a off farm or on farm, or basically off farm and non farm. The non farm will be the other 42%, but rest of them are 58%, and most of them in the rural areas. So this provides a lot of perspective in terms of any reforms that you make. How do you reach the population that really for whom these reforms are being made? It has got 16% of GDP share from agriculture, but you will see probably the year to come, maybe I presume it will be 20 plus, because of the, while other sectors are trying to cope up with the COVID, especially post-COVID scenario, agriculture is something that never stopped. People have been working, people have been at it. And sometimes some people who are familiar with Telangana, you saw that they got a bumper production of agriculture. This year's good agriculture lines, except for sporadic spoilage, there is going to be a huge production. And 295 metric ton, million tons of food grain production actually means something like we have two-thirds of what we produce is actually what we require for consumption. So balance one-third is actually necessarily we'll have to get stored or carry on for the next year if the continuously crop is good. And we already have about a year and a half to 2 years stock of food grains for our safety, food safety wise. So the country is in a very pretty good position. With the 1.3 billion population, we can feed ourselves. But advantage is that unless you do one-third of your agriculture produce, you export, especially the cereals part, we will have real tough time in terms of finding the storages for keeping it very long. And the increased acreage, especially in the states like Telangana, etc., which were basically a rain-fed crop, has come under irrigation. So you'll find more and more food grains coming there. The second part is, what are the issues in agriculture, or when you talk of some kind of these reforms? One is the land holdings and productivity. The land holdings are so small, so even if you increase the productivity, is it going to really matter? Because your ability to increase the productivity is very limited because of the smaller size. You can't do mechanization, you can't do what you call, you can't do the apply any of the what you call isolation problems if you want to any make a world class products without pesticides, etc. So this is something, plus land holding itself is a lead by which you get the finance in this country, unless you have it in your name, etc. So one is the land holding and their titles. Number two is the land holding size. So will be the productivity is low because of the everybody. It's a free country. You can produce whatever you want. It's the first time the Telangana state is saying, you grow what we tell you, so that we buy everything from you. That's something, if it makes sense, it will come. Because of the land holding size also, a relative one is the wastage, and our logistics and post-harvest techniques are so primitive in many of the remote places. We are not able to really get any advantage of that. Third one is, given these facts, we have three goals which we thought we should be looking at the, from the point of view what I said, is that doubling the farmer's income is something everyone is working for. So what do you need for that? Doubling the farming income means, one, you have to increase the either prices or productivity so that the farmer gets more revenue. And then he should also get in engaging activities in which the value addition to the basic raw material happens at the farm level. I think these are the two ways one can look at it. Then if I, as I said, if one third has to, of the food supply has to go out, and also post-COVID, the food safety and quality assurance is something which has become very, very, very important for everybody, because even a middle-class family today looking for a safe food and also quality food, because while your all other expenses have come, India's spend about 5 to 7% of their money, of their salaried income, middle class spend on only food, only that much. So people are willing to spend today staying at home. They want to get it. So good food and also quality food. It actually means that you have to do work across value chain. Are you able to hear me properly?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Then things like oil seeds and pulses are the two commodities where we are perpetual shortage, especially in pulses. And we are solely dependent on Myanmar and Australia and Canada, only three countries. Other people, they don't produce so much pulses, and India is a huge consumption, world's largest consumption of pulses. While, so there is close to 10 million tons of shortage of pulses depending on the season, approximately that much. And this actually had a lot of problem, which you will see in terms of, as we go ahead, we'll especially I'll talk about pulses, what were the issues. Because there's a constant export, import you have to do, and no export can be done. Same thing with oil seeds, you can't export. So there were huge restrictions when there is a shortage of food, any category of food, if it is there, then we have a lot of restrictions that is coming in. We'll see why. So let me probably, why this amendment had to come. Let me start from the bottom. The intended, it was always intended to only protect consumers when the when the imports are high, or try to, like pulses, because we started with pulses. Let me give the same example. These pulses, because government do not want the prices to go up, they're all canalized. They're all gone through canalized agencies, and only they can import. Traders in Mumbai, etc., we can buy again, but they have to buy through them at a price. Prices, I'm sure some of you must have seen, it went up to 160 rupees, 150 rupees. Then we had to import a lot of pulses. And that's how we are bringing the prices of the pulses down by making it imported from these countries. That's where the problem started. When the prices went up, people started hoarding them. So they buy it, imported, and then keep it in the godown, don't release it to the market. So that's where the cartels have formed, and then prices have become artificially kept high, even though we had stocks. So that is the reason the first Essential Commodities Act has come into picture, because you cannot store more than, I think it was 30 or 40 tons or whatever was the requirement. He said you can't. And this again changed from state to state. Sometimes they were very, very strict. And people couldn't just put, this is a non-bailable warrant if you are found holding any of these Essential Commodities Act. From my own experience, I remember these Essential Commodities Act is done by excise people also sometimes in Rajasthan state. This, they found that the 30 bags of extra oil seeds were there. So they said, we will close down your plant. So it's that difficult. And we were importing oil. And the imported oil, within that 48 hours, you have to vacate the tanks. Otherwise, you will have an excess quantity than what is permitted by the government at the ports. So people had a tough time in unloading the oil and also selling the oil. And people can come and check with you, because for that short period of 3-4 days, the commodities are in the importer's name. Even that is considered to be a offense. And sometimes if you are found holding more quantity than what is prescribed in the limit, they can just arrest you. They can arrest the directors also. So to get out of the problem, lot of corruption, lot of issues that had really come into the picture. So this is something, this was a background. And then let's see, India also is considered to be a not a reliable exporter of agriculture commodities. I don't know how many of you seen the paper today. Any of you remember that, what was the thing that got banned today? Export of?
Onion, sir.
Onion, excellent. Because if you really go back to this Essential Commodities Act, they said, when we go to the next slide, I'll show you, onions was one of the list. The reason they are saying that, they're expecting the prices to go up. They said, I'm removing this act, but in case, if the price go up by 50% by perishables and 50% for the staples and 100% for for the perishables, they said they can put the Essential Commodities Act back. So it is only now June, July, August, and within the fourth month, we are seeing one commodity being again brought back into Essential Commodities Act. And they have banned exports. And this happened between even 2015 and 16. I think they have done 3 times the ban of wheat, rice, and maize. So even if you do all the work to work with the farmers to export in the export market, you do not know when government will put a ban. Then what happens to all the orders that are pending? What happens to the future buyer? Does he look at India as a consistent supplier? Because government's Act on Essential Commodity Act was the first one which was preventing fear. So what I've done now, we will see in the next slide, but that's something which helped hopefully the export of agriculture commodities. Then there was several restrictions on these commodities, as I explained to you, including keeping at the factories, at the port, at a godown, but there is no account of any storage methodology in India. It was never fully developed kind of a stuff. So we don't know, unless other than the importers and exporters, we don't have any reliable data on where it is stored, because India doesn't have so much of warehouse sitting facilities and warehouse receipt facility. Nobody has taken money on that. So it is there with the private traders. So our information is also very, very, so what India did was, the government did was to put a blanket stock limits under. It did not, they thought it will help them to reduce the price. But the same thing was applied for processors also. So a processor, unless his factory runs round the clock, he will never make his money. So if there is a stock limit is unreasonable, you will never be able to run. Every second day you have to close down the plant, or it is running idle with no raw material. So these were the some issues of background when under which the Essential Commodity Act was reformed. So the current amendment, what it has done is actually limits to be imposed under exceptional circumstances like war, famine, or these conditions which I told you. 100% increase in the price for perishables and 50% price increase in the staples, that is non-perishables. But you see, within 4 months, the fear of prices going up on onions has forced the people to again do something on this Essential Commodities Act. They have banned these exports, but this is going to have ripples in the market. It's unfortunate though. That's why you see the deregulated sale of cereals, pulses, edible oils, onions, and potatoes. But exception, just today, when we are doing this presentation, onions is banned. So this is something, I think, while it is doing something good, let's see what are the challenges and those ones. Then, regarding the stock limits, not applicable for a processor or VC player. VC is a value chain player in any agri-produce. Suppose you are doing value addition of making a paddy to rice. That is your cereals. Or even doing some decortication of groundnuts. So those are the ones, their limits do not applicable for them. Because they literally threatened me, as I told you in the example of ITC. They threatened me, they will close on the plant and they'll put me behind the bars. For having a 30 bags of extra of mustard seeds. So it is like, so now it will, the processors hopefully will have a protection from this act, and then the regulating stock limits is not applicable to any of these processors or exporters, because you have fixed the export order so you can buy. Unless you have sufficient quantity, you can't put onto the ship. So you have this disadvantage of doing it. So now the applicable rules are not applicable to them. This essential commodity totally been repealed. So this is a great boon, but you see the advantages, except that they have done for onions, but I think it's a very good positive act in terms of going ahead. So let's look at what are the challenges here is that the moment you remove this inadequate information of private trade, that people do not know where to, they can even store this in a small village or somewhere else, and the information is not published anywhere. So we do not know the what stock positions we have, whether we should import or export, etc., etc. Previously, these excise department or whoever was in charge of to make you this, they know who are the people who handle it and they have a stock. Once it is repealed, unless you put it back for specific reasons, you won't have any information on the trade that is happening and what are the stocks. Consumers could be at mercy of traders because this cartel formation, which is very popular in pulses especially. The trades which are there in Maharashtra or in Madhya Pradesh, they decide how do we handle this to the market. And they decide the price rather than actual demand and supply. They distort the demand and supply picture. Will it really control the prices is something we have to yet to see. Because we don't have the information, we don't have the demand conditions, we don't have the supply. So it may move into some mercy of some traders. And people can create an artificial scarcity. That's something we will have to watch. So right now, if somebody said onions are shortage, you have to rely in the markets and we don't have any proper information system that's available. But what it does in terms of what are the kind of opportunities we have in during this is that prevention of wastages is that hopefully the goods will move freely and people also put investments into cold storages because now that there is no control by government, say the state government or central government, they will start putting investment into storages, which will prevent a lot of wastage and because even if you want to store high moisture and rats, etc., eat away most of this agriculture produce staples. So that's something they can take because you can put a better godowns both for staples as well as for the cold storages. And that investments hopefully will start coming in because of this ban. And even the producers, people who are actually processing will start putting in investments into that. And hopefully that will give a price stability for farms and consumers because farmers, the reason is that a factory which is there in a production center can actually announce a rate and they can start keeping it with them. So from here, we will move into the next one in terms of APMC Act. Krishna, I think my power has gone. In case if I am not coming in, I'll use my phone.
Yes, sir. We have others to share the screen. So if you want, we can ask team members to share.
It will work only if my this one is gone. I will take that 1 minute to switch to my phone right now.
Okay, sir. No problem.
I know every day I have so many meetings, only when something like this, only this happens. Okay. When you are not listening to me, you have to either call me or do something so that I know. Okay.
Sure,
I think this, my support system will hold it for some time, but if it's for longer period, then internet will go off. So this is the APMC background for this is that these APMC registrations are depending on the states. And a state like Punjab has got 1 to 8% APMC mandi tax. And there are states where these mandis are not fully developed at all. They are in the hands of half of Andhra Pradesh. There are not many APMC market yards. But in other places where they are very developed, they are there. So it is again a state. How will the put the restriction? And restriction on selling agri-produce, they say that you can't take it out from the mandi and sell it outside. All the produce has to come through mandi and you have to sell it. So this restriction has made into a lot of malpractices at mandi level. That is, if 10 trucks are sold in mandi, 30-40 trucks are sold outside the system also. So that not only reduces the revenue at the mandi, but there are a lot of things that happen which they call it zero billing or whatever it is. I'm talking about a little practical, so not to be taken on a bad side, but I'm saying this used to happen because of the too many restrictions from the APMC Act. And farmers are forced to sell only to the licensed government. If you have seen any mandi, vegetable mandi, or anywhere you go here, there are people who do the trade there are licensed, and every trade has to go through them only. So that restricts the freedom of the farmer to go to any place, and then you have only 100 or 120 licensed people only, you have to do business with them. But it's also barriers of free flow between the states also was not there. Groundnut is grown in Anantapur, but most of it goes and get processed in Bellary. The reason is, you can't actually move it. So what they used to do is make a list of farmers and then send it across individually. So a lot of malpractices, but still goods used to move where economies of plants are there. The expeller plants are there more in Anantapur. So they used to go there and have it. So this is a kind of background of amendments. And what is the current amendment does is that free intrastate and interstate to the farmers. See, typically, even if you look at any of the goods, we go by the state borders. But agriculture is not based on the state borders. It is based on the agroclimatic zones, right? So there are many places, the developed markets are in Maharashtra. So most of the Telangana produce goes to Maharashtra by illegal means if required, because that is the shortest market that is available to the farmer. You may put any restriction, but a farmer will figure out a way where he makes most money. And this can happen to many states in Karnataka border, as I explained, if a groundnut. And a lot of these oil seeds and others go from soybean, go from Andhra Pradesh, or the current Telangana to Maharashtra. This you can't do because economics will take over the restrictions and whatever you have. So current one actually allows you to move from state to state, whichever state you want to do, you can do the transfer. And traders need not pay, the traders to have to pay the farmers within 3 days of their purchase. And any person, FPC or FPO or cooperative can set up an electronic trading platform. That's going to be a great opportunity as we see in the next slide. But this is something anybody can set up in the nearest place, an FPO or a cooperative or a PACS, can primary agriculture cooperative societies, can set up an electronic platform and farmer can go there, put his stock, and then some buyer from somewhere else can come and pick it up. So it becomes a free trade possibility for many people. And that's where the farmer, because instead of having one Mandi, you will have many people who want to continue. And if it is a private Mandi kind of thing, if they set up, they have to, no need to pay anything else. But previously, even when we were in ITC, we did a project with Pepsi, etc. Even if you do the some Mandi product outside your system, you have to pay the Mandi tax. That is compulsory. Now, if you do outside the Mandi system, you don't have to pay anything. So you can do a free trade. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because I'm a power, then my voice, internet is cut off. I should let know, that's all. So this current one actually say, what are the opportunities we have is that creation of free trade ecosystem for agri producers. That means even if the processing center is in Maharashtra in a border and that guy is willing to directly buy from the farmer can actually load in his own tractor and take it across the state and sell, no restrictions. Nobody will stop you on the way. Then barrier-free intrastate and interstate, trade outside the APMC laws. So you don't have to even go to Mandi. You are in Adilabad, you don't want to go to Adilabad Mandi. Take your tractor and go to Maharashtra and sell your product. And so, yeah, especially, you can do that. More choices and avenue for the farmers to reduce market costs. For example, let's say there is a plant in closer to in Maharashtra border and willing to buy soya meal on a price which is 10% more than market price of the whatever the market yard. Farmer can go straight away sell it. So it gives a choice. I don't have to go to a Mandi. I don't have to go to a cooperative. But if there's somebody else who is willing to pay a higher price and willing to put the pick up my produce and pay me within 3 days or sometimes even cash, he can do that. That gives him a choice. Previously he had to go through a Mandi. Now there is no more Mandi. One India and one market. One market is basically the things like all can be interchangeable. You can have Enam. You have a lot of platforms that you will probably understand this, that these platforms can be set up by anybody and it's a farm market. And all of them, India is a marketplace now. If you get more price in Tamil Nadu, you go there. If you get more price in Madhya Pradesh, you go there. As long as your economics is, they work out. So farmer with surplus commodities can directly even link with other needy farmers. Basically the rice that is produced goes across many places on Ellur rice or whatever specific rice. But previously what happened is the AP government had restriction on the nice varieties of the thin varieties of rice. They put a restriction so that they can't go outside the state. Now it doesn't matter. If somebody in Delhi is willing to pay 4 truckloads at a price much higher, he can go. So also you can also give it to the other farmers. Basically what they're saying is you can, farmers of non-rice growing people also can directly indent and take it from here. And electronic platforms bring seamless trade and payment mechanism. See now I don't know how to explain this. I don't have any full detail or a diagram on that, but the wheat that is purchased by ITC in Madhya Pradesh, if he gives it to the factory or to the e-chopals, as everything is quality is done, parameters are done, and by the time he reaches home, the money is in his bank account. So electronic platforms are something which will seamless trade. You just unload your stuff. Everything is calculated like you do in milk now. It's all accounted and printed and given it to you. But here, one more step is even the payment system is integrated to it. So payment will go to the bank accounts directly. And only problem here is if there is any problem between the private trader or a platform and the farmer, we need to have a separate dispute resolution mechanism, which is not there. And it's more so for the next change that has come, that's called contract farming. But even for APMC Act, if there is any problems of dispute of payments or quality, etc., you need a mechanism, somebody you can solve. Right now, I think person who can do this solve is not a very senior officer from the state. But the problem is even that person is so much have all other duties. they call it district magistrates or assistant district magistrates. But they have so many other duties. They have the election duties, they have law and order, now the COVID. So how many of them they'll be able to do? So we need to have a separate system of, that's something we'll have to figure it out, and that's a way we can, so that things can be solved without going anywhere. So what has happened in terms of over a period of these things is here, after the things of announcement, what has happened was one of the major challenges were people stopped going to the markets. Many, many farmers stopped going to the markets. So if you look at it, the drop in the arrivals, as you see in this picture, is the fruits about 49% during the same period over last year. Vegetables about 57%, grains about 45%. This is the drop in APMCs from June to August for the same period. And many FPOs and places, actually, they're not going to APMCs at all. And many of them started their own platforms, or they're going through the private platforms or through ENAMs. So only about half of the quantities are actually going through the current APMC. So what will happen if these kind of things, people skip going to APMCs? One of the things is that directly buying from the farmers on a large scale. For example, Samunati itself has a platform, and people restricted movement, they don't want to go to very long distances, and you are not getting vehicles to go to very long distance, the trucks, etc. So the FPOs and others started buying directly, and I think Samunati itself developed a platform and did about 20 crores of trade. So this is something that's going to happen. This is a challenge for APMCs as well as for these people. They have to figure out a way to do the smaller markets, and then APMCs will start losing business because nobody will go there, because why pay extra mandi tax? Traders purchasing mandi still have to pay mandi tax. That is, if you go and buy in a APMC mandi, you have to still pay that mandi tax. It can be 1% to 8%, as I told you. So people also preferring, and their trade margins are very low. Typically buy and sell, the margins in the commodities are typically less than 2%. So they don't want to go and pay another 1.5%. So they started doing on their own. Even traders at APMC are competing with traders outside not paying taxes, because they have to pay because they're sitting in the mandi. They have to pay. But another major problem that comes also because of this thing is that a lot of these traders will also move out and set up their own shops. Okay, these are certain challenges we have. Before that, other problem I just wanted to say that there are issue of price discovery. Right now, government is giving you a price data analysis based on your mandi arrivals and mandi prices. But tomorrow, if it comes to almost say 20-30% and most of it done outside, the electronic media probably you should be able to do. But somebody is buying and farmer is supplying to a processor or anybody else, you won't have any data. The data is going to be a big problem in terms of pricing. How do you know correct price of the commodity? It's going to be a major challenge in terms of, because people will go directly to the traders. They will go through electronic platforms. Do we have a reporting mechanism? We don't have a reporting mechanism. So we don't know how the prices movements, like what you're getting today on a APMC, will supply you arrivals data and also the price data. The price discovery is going to be another major challenge, as I see. This is something we should understand. It's called the, it's also called Contract Act, the Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement on Price Assurance and Farm Services Ordinance. This is on the contract farming. This contract farming is that a farmer can enter into contract with farming agreement with any specific agreements on the specifications. That is, this is the quality of maize, this is the oil content, this is what the each bag will have. So we have, then you have to supply at this price to me after your crop is over. So this is something you can enter into a contract. The agreement period can be from first 1 to 5 years, because the processor may want an assured crop. or an exporter want an export, for example, your baby corn or gherkins. So these things they may want. But the price of variation to be in the agreement, disputes, etc., it has to go through APMC, AZ, all any other EDM is one of those private companies. Whatever is the benchmark, you have to keep some prices and compare whether you're getting the rice price or not. But the contract typically says that if there's an APMC price plus 10% is the contract, then according to that, the contract is valid. Or like potatoes, when I was in basics, we did with prices are fixed at 5 rupees, 4.50, depending on the future price. And there are many issues at that point of time that if the prices are high in the market, farmers is to go there. If prices are low, they will give more than the quantity what the company wanted. So this is something we call it side sell. That's something you can, which was not implementable in India, most of these agreements. But now these under this act, I think hopefully we should get more and more people coming into the contract act, and they will help the farmers to get into a formal contract. There is a protection mechanism for them to not being exploited, etc., etc. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So some of the concerns we have in this contract forming is that individual farmer may not be able to negotiate corporates, because some big company comes, I want ADM or Ruchi Soya. Somebody says, I want to buy soybeans at this rate. He may have to go by the general rate that is available. So especially for those products like gherkins or some of those specific products of their specifications, you can't sell outside also. So in that case, whatever the company fixes, that's what it should be. And they don't have great bargaining power. But quality will be mutually decided, which could lead into unfair practices. Because in potato, when Pepsi does, they only give the seed material. They will say, I want only so much. They will give you a sieve, that anything that is above the sieve only, they will buy. And they won't buy the substandard material. So what will the farmer do with that? So that's an issue. And if somebody, farmer doesn't supply, or companies brings down the price, what do they do? So these disputes is something we'll have to really look at it contract form. But this is a good way as I said, that if India has to export 1/3 of the total production of agriculture into export market, in which case contract is a must for him to make sure that he can further, if his price is fixed at 5 or 6 rupees, then they can work with the farmer so that they at least get their returns. But he can negotiate with his buyer saying that this is going to be price, and he can also stagger his production in such a way that there is a continuous supply of the product. So this is something which is very good coming from a corporate world. I believe he can actually have a good contract with the farmers, and it can help them also. This is something I'm sure probably we should be able to do that. In addition to that, maybe another 6-7 minutes I'll talk. This is a part of the thing, but if you brought in the amendments, you need to support it to some of the things to reach our goals of doubling the farmers' income. So from that point of view, you've seen this is something Atmanirbhar Bharat has got a lot of money that was provided for various things. For example, 1 billion, close to 100 crores for the creating the farm gate infrastructure. If you one side you are removing the APMCs, then if the farmers have to have a nearby, what else that needs to be there? Creating infrastructure for electronic platforms, storages, go down. So for that, they have provided the money. And also for the micro food enterprises, because India, as far as I remember, most of the food processing industries operate less than their installed capacity, because one, it's a seasonal. Number two, the capacities are imported, the plants are imported to the capacities which they do in Western world, which doesn't work for India. What we require is micro food enterprises, say groundnut processing, chickies, or you can call it, what is it, snack foods, but of good quality, but many. That's where they are provided this money, so that these people put them, and even this processed food market is going to be a huge market. And as per the Niti Aayog and other people's estimate, the new demand that is going to come for exports is from Gulf and Saudi and that part of the area, and also some parts of Africa. So this is something we need to figure it out, that we need to make those products, at least the 1/3 of our agriculture products, for specifically for value-added agri products, which requires very highly specialized, probably smaller food enterprises, which will be of that standard. Then for the fishermen, separately they are provided for, and some to prevent wastage, especially harvesters, and then your implements, and for those ones they are provided, and also godowns, etc. Then we also for beekeeping, which is again additional, separately they have given, but it's more to do with organic and international demand for a good organic honey. And herbal cultivation is something now you must have seen post-COVID, the consumption has increased. I don't know how many times somebody has to do the study, but it's a huge, multiple times herbal and Indian medication is being taken by most of us people here. And animal husbandry in dairy is something which we need to do, because initial periods of these developments happened because of the government work on Operation Flood, etc., etc. Now it's the industry is totally open. It's like APMC Act removed, the Industries Act repealed. So there's no protection for dairy industry. Anybody can come in, but producers are still small. So we require the animal husbandry as a livelihood support for the people to increase or double the farmers' income, because you can't take out allied activities from agriculture. So this is the reason these monies have been provided. But all these things put together with a APMC Act, and then Essential Commodities Act and Contract Act, gives that fillip to whatever we do, increase our food production, reduce the wastages, and also make sure that we export those ones. So where do we go from here? This is the kind of things, hope you kind of figured it out, what kind of reforms and what kind of support government is giving. From where do we go from here? One is the coordination between center and state. I think today, if somebody has seen, center has proposed some electricity bill and the state is not willing to take it. Similarly, agriculture being a state subject, if they do not find any value in what is being proposed, they don't want to do it. They don't want to subsidize other states for by losing their own income. So anything that works out, state government might put restrictions because they have the final say. Also the disputes for contract farming, which is something we need to figure it out, which we talked about, that the prices go outside market very high and your contract is at 30-40% lesser. Then we don't have a mechanism today to how to reconcile these kind of problems. In industry sector, all you do is give a subsidy, but we don't have that kind of mechanism here in agriculture. That kind of subsidized input or something we don't have, but we have to figure it out. The second one is incentivize state for good, for making this implement so that they get a larger share of the income or what are the benefit that they're getting it. So this is something which state government will have to work, because these all are the national reforms, but state has to feel part of it, and also they get the benefit out of it. The appeal should start hitting minimum support price to promote by promoting corporate farming. For example, today prices of chicken is not given by minimum support price of I'll buy at 80 rupees or 90 rupees. No. It's open to the industries, so they figure out how to do the, this kind of prices, which is remunerative. So you'll find in poultry, lot of contract farming is applicable for broilers, and they outsource, and the farmers, the poultry farmers, get the margins for their labor, but rest of them is supplied by the corporate, and they decide the price. So government do not have to come into picture, that they will figure out how to do it. Post-COVID, yes, first poultry took a beat, then because of poultry, maize took a beating. So But ultimately, the government is not able to do much to these sectors because they've already privatized it, and it's an open industry, anybody can start it. So this is what they want to do into, for example, one by one into, say, potato or onion or tomato. Can we have some contract farming for processing centers? Something like that they're looking at. Then, of course, the promote FPOs and agri startups, so that we require to bring a lot of technology if you are to do that one third of produce going out, and also increased demand for a quality product within India today requires a lot of investment and innovative solutions to this, rather than, you know, pesticide free food or etc. So that's the reason FPO is a platform, so that it doesn't have to go very far. 20-30 villages, if there's an FPO, they can sell their own produce, and the buyer can send his truck and take the material. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good. Then we are almost through. Then ensure proper implementation of law, essential commodity stock by export and processes. This is something, implementation of the law is not to punish them, but also we need to get the information from them. If we don't have an information base, I think we'll have a problem in terms of stockage, etc. We can't even estimate whether we require to import or we have to export. This is something, how do we implement these ones is something we'll have to figure it out. One is, once you take out the law, people who are monitoring it, if they're out of that, then what do you do? Then lastly, the reform existing APMC and sub-markets in rural areas as to arrest malpractices. Malpractices in terms of weight, in terms of quality, and suppose sometimes the variety also. The way APMC, market yards, mandi, if any of a chance to visit sometime in your own villages, the guy takes out at least 4-5 kilos, but by weighing alone, he makes about 2-3 kilos. The highest paid guy in a market yard is a guy who weighs the quantity of the farmer's produce. Okay, so this is all about in terms of what we need to know about this reforms, advantages, scope, and then how do you go forward in making them implemented. So I'm kind of through with my thing, what I wanted to convey. Hope you're had a good time listening to it, but I'm sure you will have more questions to ask. So we'll figure it out. These are some of the references, and this is what we all work. We make markets work with smallholder farmers. That's how Samunati put all their efforts to, in whichever area they go, it has to make it work for smallholder farmer, because we started the presentation saying that small fragmented land